I'm Mr. Ido, the acting director of IBE. I would just to like to apologize. We start in the 5 coming minutes because we are waiting for one of our personalities that we have invited for the opening ceremony, who is getting ready. So we'll very soon start in the coming minutes. So I just like to apologize for the slight delay that we are going to have. Thank you very much.
Ido?
Oui?
Hello?
Oui?
Can you hear me?
Who is speaking, please?
Stefania.
Oh, yes, Stefania, I just sent you a WhatsApp. Yes.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, I just sent you a WhatsApp. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so there's still a few minutes.
Yes, five minutes, let us see. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay.
My colleagues, can you just confirm if Honorable Minister from the Republic, Dominican Republic, is connected? Renato?
Hola.
Hello. Are you able to hear me?
The minister is
Minister Fulcar speaking.
Hola, un placer, mucho gusto.
Delighted to be here.
Okay.
Mi micrófono está apagando.
Thank you.
Christopher, on va commencer, s'il te plaît.
Let us get started. Thank you.
Christopher? OK. Mesdames et messieurs, bonsoir.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My name is Mr. Ido Yao, the Interim Director of UNESCO's International Bureau of Education, or IBE. Madam Stefania Giannini, who is Assistant Director General for Education here at UNESCO. Mr. Dodzi Kokoroko, Minister of Primary, Secondary and Technical Education in Togo. His Excellency Mr. Roberto Fulcar, Minister of Education from the Dominican Republic. Excellency Adamus, Ambassador from Côte d'Ivoire and part of the subgroup for Education in Africa. Excellencies, ambassadors, Mr. Dear ambassadors and permanent delegations to UNESCO, ministry representatives in charge of curricula, representatives of the education sector, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the entire team in the IBE, I should like, first of all, extend to you our gratitude to our ADG, Ms. Giannini, as well as the Minister of Togo and Dominican Republic for having agreed to open this webinar on the curriculum-related actions in the context. And I would like to thank Mr. Chakrund and his team as for all of their contribution in making this webinar possible. Just before I actually took the floor, my colleagues told me there were 614 people who had actually registered for this webinar and have been following us from Africa, from Latin America, from the Pacific and the Southeast Asian regions and from around the world. Today's session is going to be in English, French and Spanish, and we've put together a webinar on this particular ocean in Europe, and there'll also be a Portuguese language seminar upcoming. We wanted to offer everybody a chance to garner information about the various strategies that could be used by countries in this context. Now, before anything else, I should like to hand over to Ms. Stefania Giannini, ADG for Education.
Merci beaucoup, cher Ido.
Thank you very much, Ido.
Bonjour à tous et à toutes. Buenos días.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. Good morning,
to everybody.
Your Excellencies and dear colleagues, it's really a pleasure for me to be here with you today for this first UNESCO webinar on curriculum in the COVID-19 time. A topic that is definitely at the very heart of education efforts, as we know. This exchange is one of the many ways we are capitalizing on the International Bureau of Education's role as the global focal point and platform for knowledge, dialogue, cooperation on curriculum. Let me first say a few words about the impact of this crisis on the education systems and education as a sector globally, and to focus later on the role of IBE, the role that IBE should have in the coming months and years. The pandemic, as we know, has unfortunately amplified educational inequalities everywhere and really threatens the future of young generations. As you maybe remember, our Secretary General Antonio Guterres launching the policy brief, which UNESCO has been penholder last summer, talk about a generational catastrophe. It's in this context that UNESCO convened the Global Education Meeting last week, attended by 14 heads of state and government and over 70 ministers. And the message from that meeting was quite clear. Protect education financing, prioritize education in recovery plans, and build back more inclusive, resilient, and sustainable. The meeting's declaration is a kind of roadmap where global priorities actions has been clearly designed, and these actions are required in the next 12, 15 months to avert the generational catastrophe, the risk of generational catastrophe, which the Secretary General of the UN mentioned and I referred to before. It's about focusing on reopening schools safely, supporting teachers as frontline workers, investing in skills development, and narrowing the digital divide. Curriculum is at the heart of all these actions somehow. Learning that is organized according to classroom curricula, syllabus, and lessons plans has been disrupted definitely by COVID-19. Almost 500 million learners have been left without access to digital learning platforms, and school closures continue to sweep across more than 30 countries. These data are related to the current week. However, many countries are making significant progress in adjusting the curriculum through diverse alternate models to ensure the continuity of learning, including through radio, television, and mobile phones. We saw many kind of so-called hybrid models put in practice during the last 8-9 months. Since the outbreak of the pandemic, almost 150 partners have joined forces through UNESCO's Global Education Coalition to expand access to distance learning platforms, to train teachers to develop and use them appropriately, and digitize curricula and produce content for remote learning. We are now working with Education Cannot Wait in some countries. Let me mention Democratic Republic of the Congo, for example, to adapt the primary education curriculum as well as year 8 into radio lessons. In South Africa, the coalition has launched a WhatsApp line called Teacher Connect, which among other features, the learning curriculum for teachers in mobile format. We are also accompanying Ecuador to develop a curriculum-based guidelines for teachers and families, which are being translated to radio and text messages to reach rural communities. This is especially important as 70% of the country's population lacks connectivity. Well, I would like to share a few considerations with you on curriculum in the COVID-19 era, which are relevant for developing and developed countries as well. We said from the beginning, this is real, the very first global crisis. And this is real, the very first time in history that all countries realize that schools are at the very core of the social cohesion and are not simply, and crucially, of course, places where children learn. First, this includes identifying curriculum factors that need immediate, medium, and long-term actions in order to minimize learning losses. Second, it's important to review the relevance, appropriateness, and responsiveness of curriculum from the perspectives of education for sustainable development, global citizenship, preparedness for emergencies or health education, and associate competencies. Governments are expected to decide what to prioritize as essential in the curriculum and how to do so. There are many possible avenues for meeting curriculum expectations with the reduced instruction time, for instance, through integrated and transdisciplinary learning. Responsive approaches to implementing the curriculum need to be strengthened, such as through online or blended learning. Thanks to technological advances, learning can happen anywhere and anytime. Through personalized contents, pathways, and interactions, which are not limited by time, space, or teachers. This is where the digitalization of curriculum is especially important. Last but not least, open educational resources and agile learning development by multiple actors, such as national curriculum development centers or social media, require a paradigm shift. The pandemic has had devastating effects on education, but it's also an opportunity. Let me stress this point. Every crisis can offer a great opportunity to change, to transform. And this opportunity is about reimagining and laying foundations for the future of lifelong learning. It's an occasion to revamp IBE somehow, to relaunch the role of IBE globally, and IBE as the real peer role, crucial role to respond to the needs of member states in this specific sector, curriculum development, and foster a forward-looking vision to contribute to equitable and inclusive education sustainable development. I thank you very much, and I wish you a real productive and fruitful conversation today.
Merci beaucoup, Stefania.
Thank you very much, Stefania, for those words of support, and especially for having reminded us of the difficulties that await us in the post-COVID world. Thank you so much. I should like now to give the floor to His Excellency the Minister from the Dominican Republic. You have the floor, sir.
Señora Stefania Giannini.
Ms. Giannini, ADG for UNESCO for the education sector. Ms. Giaido, Acting Director for the International Education Office of UNESCO. Mr. Samuel Conde, Head of Business Activity for Education in the Dominican Republic, ladies and gentlemen, please receive a cordial welcome from the people and government of the Dominican Republic. The highest levels that can take up education in a democratic government is to guarantee egalitarian and free access for all children, adolescents, and young people to quality education. For that reason, today I wish to reiterate an idea that is crucial to us, that education constitutes the most important tool for breaking the chains of reproducing a lack of progress and to create the necessary preconditions for sustainable development. Our wish is to convert this difficulty into a great opportunity to create a new education model, which is inclusive, relevant, and transcendental with high quality. Our Education for All plan, preserving health, which we've already begun to implement with the pre-university education system in the Dominican Republic, is allowing us to fill in the gaps and guarantee that no one is left behind. To do this, we have articulated a whole series of different measures, including television, radio, printed material, internet, and others. Also, alternative vehicles for the development of relevant skills for our students. Our great challenge is to guarantee the continuity of the educational process without endangering the health or lives of our students, the educational community, or of their families, all of whom are threatened by the presence of COVID-19. And in this way, to guarantee education for all, preserving health for all. We would require that the 2.8 million students in our educational systems do not interrupt their studies and do not lose time in the most productive period of their lives from the viewpoint of acquiring knowledge. But we are confronting the problem that we cannot go back to classrooms without a serious risk of massive coronavirus contagion. Aware of the transcendental nature of education in the COVID-19 context, the Ministry of Education of the Dominican Republic has undertaken dialogue with different sectors that represent the country, with social organizations, institutions that are linked to education. And we have also spoken with international organizations that work with education in different contexts, so as to arrive at solutions and to break the vicious cycle of problems that we confront. We can see, for instance, that as we were not able to start the 2020-21 school year in presentia, we have been obliged to fall back on distance learning, rather than simply sitting back and waiting for the pandemic to end. We have decided to carry out the school year in a non-presential mode using distance learning. But for this, we need the support of families, and to say that fathers and mothers will accompany and support us in this process so as to guarantee that their children have good performance. We've consulted families and heard that 98% of them are prepared to participate in this process. Dominican families, however, even though they are committed to education for their children and ready to help out, do not have the necessary methodological skills so that they can work in an effective way and to make helping their children agreeable. So we have decided to undertake the necessary induction measures for fathers, mothers, and guardians. And this program for families will be revised and updated with the help of teachers. But it also happens that our teachers do not necessarily have the necessary training either in use of technology applied to education or in some areas of distance learning or non-presential teaching. And they have a very important role to play. There is an enormous potential for a new normal in education. And to that end, making our projects come true means that there will be an arduous process of setting up tools necessary for each teacher and each student. It also means we have to guarantee connectivity of homes and undertake an innovative process of priority setting for curriculum and training of our teachers in the fields of education technology for distance learning under the supervision of the Ministry of Education. This process already represents a big step forward, having national coverage through all of the televisions in the country using traditional TV and also cable and other forms of broadcasting and transmission. We've also tried to guarantee that national broadcasters will support the process so that all of our students may have access to education beginning next Monday, November 2nd. We will have a simplification of the curriculum, which is already well underway, with content that have been and will go on being adapted to the scripts and other supports that will be used by many producers throughout the country, put in a group of 50 teachers who were chosen in national casting so as to be model teachers for the Dominican Republic. We have carried out this plan over all of our country's territory using guides which will allow families to lead the learning of their students together with teachers. We find ourselves in the midst of a training process for teaching staff where we need to have the involvement of 100% of teachers in the public sector and a large percentage of those from the private sector who are receiving content via all the digital platforms and other means of communication that we can use. We are preparing to graduate citizens of the world for today and for tomorrow. And to do this, we see within our education plan, a citizen's charter, which will be a basis to support curriculum development and other educational plans, and in this way, to arrive at a supply of education which is congruent with the demands of today's world for everyone. The citizens' charters will constitute a whole series of different projects that will contribute to integrated learning, including a strengthening of their identity and a healthy system, a feeling of belonging to their country, and participating in a national heritage system, making them citizens who are respectful of life and of society, guided by values and national patriotism, with intellectual capacity to formulate well-founded judgments on their own actions and those of others, and to participate in a critical fashion, also productively and assertively, in today's society. We are working on a plan so as to provide every week raw foods to families as well, on the basis of 5 basic foodstuffs. We're following the FAO's basic food tables, talking about the necessary nutrients which citizens must have, to giving priority to national products with raw foodstuffs that will respect health protocols, and to deliver these weekly via educational centers to families and to get them to each household directly on the basis of the number of students that each household has. We hope that the Sustainable Development Goal 4, guaranteeing inclusive, equitable, and high quality education and promoting lifelong learning for everyone, will very soon be a beautiful reality throughout the world. The Dominican Republic, under the leadership of our president, has the determination to meet that goal, making the necessary economic investments so as to finance these unprecedented policies for the history of the Dominican Republic. Ladies and gentlemen, let us aspire to be able to reach our goals throughout the world. We will work together. We will convert the world to a gigantic schoolroom, using new technologies where people will be able to learn every day. I thank you for your attention. Thank you very much indeed, Minister, for this overview of the different problems which COVID has illuminated in our school systems, and also the different ways forward that you have emphasized in terms of necessary educational reforms. Thank you very much indeed for your remarks. Let me now give the floor to the minister from the Republic of Togo. Mr. Minister, if you are connected, you have the floor, sir. I was told there were some difficulties with the minister's connection. I also got a message saying he was able to connect. So, Minister, if you have been able to connect, we are all ears. If not, let me then suggest, Stefania, if you would accept doing this, that we forge ahead, and that if at some point the minister is able to connect, we could stop what we are doing to be able to give him the floor at that time. I see that Stefania seems to agree.
Oui, bien sûr.
Yes, of course. Then, thank you very much, Stefania. Ladies and gentlemen, the contribution that we have just heard from the minister from the Dominican Republic, and that which we will hear from the minister from Togo, represent the 3 main opening speeches.
Ladies and gentlemen, after the opening ceremony, we are now going to start our technical sessions. But before, let me give the floor very quickly to one of my colleagues, Madame Perrine, for a few useful information before we go to the technical sessions. Perrine, please. Perrine?
Okay. Anyway, the informations are on the slides just for you to know about them, and they will share them with the panelists. Okay, it's now my pleasure. Let us go to the session, technical sessions. It's now my pleasure to invite my colleague Dakmara to take the floor for the first session. Dakmara is a UNESCO colleague from Beirut office. So we are going to start. Dakmara, you have the floor for the introduction of the first session, and then we take it from there. Dakmara, please.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Ido. Good afternoon, bonjour, sabah al khair. I'm very pleased to introduce the panelists for this first session to discuss the impact on curriculum of the COVID-19 crisis. As you know, during these difficult times, it's not that easy for us to travel. Not that easy as it used to be. So I'm very happy to invite you now for a virtual journey from the Americas to Asia and then to Africa. We have three panelists who each have 5 minutes. So please, dear panelists, be brief. And after your 5 minutes, I have then to alert you about the timekeeping. We will start with the Americas with Mr. Samuel Conde from the Dominican Republic, who is a very good example of a happy marriage between the world of business and education. He's a businessman, a business person, very important business person, but he's also very interested in education. He's the president of EDUCA. So Mr. Samuel Conde, the floor is yours, please. Mr. Conde.
Thank you very much. Yes, 1 second, let me eliminate the language interpretation here. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, please.
Very well, I will speak in Spanish. Señora Stefania Giannini, Assistant Director General de la UNESCO.
EDG of UNESCO.
Para.
For.
1 second, please. Let me. Where are you?
Señora Stefania Giannini. Ms. Stefania Giannini, Assistant Director General of UNESCO for the education sector. Mr. Ido. Acting Director for the International Education Office of UNESCO, ministers, national authorities, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me thank UNESCO for the invitation to participate in this meeting. Let me also congratulate the International Education Office for the leadership role that it goes on playing, helping to rethink education in present circumstances. In particular, under the directorship of João Ido, whose support has been invaluable to EDUCA and for the Dominican Republic. The world has changed practically from one day to the next. When in March, the World Health Organization declared a pandemic situation as the result of the accelerated spread of COVID-19. The Dominican Republic also changed. We all regret the loss of 10,000 lives of our compatriots.
We also witnessed an acceleration in the very slowdown of the economic. The economic impact has been devastating. In education, as for education, we've seen devastating results as well. Everything that we had learned thus far might actually be of interest to other countries when it comes to the post COVID recovering in developing and developed countries. More than 28 million children found that they dropped out of education, never to return. We've been working hand in hand and to try and prevent this being being a further widespread phenomenon. The very first lesson that we'd like to share with you is that now is the time to get involved in everything that can unite all stakeholders in society to overcome the problem, and even more so in the little things, like to focus on the things that unite us more than the things that separate us. It's very important to understand that national authorities might have a leadership role, but they are not able to resolve this alone, given the magnitude of the challenge before us. Remember that education, together with the private sector, can work together to try to look at the renewal of educational systems and curricula. It means that the roles of technology, of teaching, the use of time has been reviewed more than ever before. Also, in these times of emergency and these exceptional circumstances, it's important to bring all of this on board. This pandemic, secondly, offers us an opportunity to review and refine our curricula. What is it that students learn, and how do they do it? How is the timing of their learning in our current systems? What needs to be changed if we're going to ensure that they can continue learning even in times of lockdown and crisis? What we've realized is that the technological aspects that are available for us to use in the current circumstances need to be truly put at the service of students' learning. But it might mean that we're going to have to think more carefully about the role of technology, the use of time, the teaching function, and the relativization of face-to-face classes combined with remote work. And all of this really, I think, will enable us to perfect the system with the students' learning at the heart. This is what's been happening in the Dominican Republic, and we do think that this could serve as a model to be replicated elsewhere. The third lesson that I wanted to share with you is our conviction that for education, the pandemic has shone a strong light on the important role of the family when it comes to children's education. The home, mothers, fathers, the family serve as co-educators along with the main role of teachers. And finally, a fourth and final lesson that we've learned is that technology plays a very relevant role and has huge potential for the new normal in education, but it remains merely instrumental. Teachers are still key to the learning process of all students. And yet, the actions there and the modalities with which we use this and this combined effect of teachers plus technology needs to be fine-tuned so that we can ensure that we still stimulate in students that love of learning, their curiosity, and so that they can reach their fullest potential. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Samuel Conde. You made my job as a moderator very easy. So perfect timekeeping. And you also helped us to realize again that this crisis is also an opportunity, especially, for instance, for curriculum, because for long people request the different changes, different types of reforms for the curriculum. And now you said it's maybe the momentum for this long-lasting request to take shape, for people to think, to rethink what students should learn and how to learn, and to do this by uniting forces, by uniting stakeholders, and also working very closely with families. So thank you very much for this first contribution. And I just want to mention that you will have also a chance to respond to some questions or comments that will come at the end. Dakmara, so now, yes.
Excuse me, I have been informed that the Minister of Togo is now online. Let us give him 2 minutes okay. for his intervention, please. Monsieur le ministre okay. du Togo, vous avez la parole, s'il vous plaît, monsieur le ministre.
You have the floor. Minister, you have the floor. Monsieur le ministre. Minister of Education from Togo, you have the floor, sir. I have been told that he is online and yet we cannot hear him. Perhaps there is a technical problem. So forgive me, Mr. Minister, please feel free to interrupt us at any time if you are able to connect. Dakmara, let us continue in the meantime. Thank you.
Yes, Dr. Ido. So we'll now switch to Asia, to Malaysia, to our colleague, Mrs. Sue Boon, Dr. Sue Boon, who is a curriculum specialist. So we talked about the momentum for curriculum changes. So with no further ado, I will give the floor to Dr. Sue Boon, who is also working for the Ministry of Education. With the curriculum division. She's the deputy head of the curriculum division and she is also a university professor. So, Dr. Sue Boon, please.
Thank you, Dakmara. So I'm glad to be here to share some of my views. I was working in the Ministry of Education, curriculum developer, but currently I am in a university. In the past few 10 months, I think the most used words, the word that we always heard about is COVID-19. And all of us are being advised that we avoid places with lots of people. And unfortunately, school is such a place. And when school is being locked down, there are lots of problems, lots of challenges that we face. And thank you, IBE, for organizing this webinar. Curriculum developers and implementers do need to put our heads together to think about what to do. I have five discussion points here. And the purpose of this discussion point is to provoke our thoughts and generate discussions. My first point is about rethinking curriculum design. Conventionally, curriculum, whether at preschool level, primary, secondary, or even tertiary, we organized it linearly in a very fixed time frame. Traditionally, we actually let time dictate our curriculum designing, actually. So I think in this pandemic, we face this problem when students don't go to school, we become worried. If they have not learned what they should be learning today, so how are they going to follow up tomorrow? So I think at this point, we have to rethink post-COVID-19, the way we develop curriculum, probably we cannot be developing it in a linear manner. It can't be topics after topics. We have to think of some way. We have to think deeply about that. Yeah, there must be a feasible design. The second thing that I think we have been doing is that we have been heavily focusing on standalone disciplines or subject matter. And in the time of this pandemic, we can hear so many stories of the brave health workers, the police force, the synergy around us, the sacrifices, and also the negative lessons of selfish human nature. So all this actually can be very good learning for our students, but we are not capitalizing on it. So therefore, I think we have to rethink curriculum in the sense that what is important for us to teach the children for the school or even in the university, is it merely academic stuff? Or that we should be looking at learning in a more thematic or problem-based curriculum design or more integrated like what Stefania has mentioned earlier. And probably we have to also look at process-based curriculum design. And traditionally, we kind of rank subjects. So for example, in some countries, when we have limited time for the children to learn in school, we kind of like, okay, maybe certain subject like science of maths, they think is more important. So you teach that rather than you take away the art education and all, because you think that's not so important. But I think we have to realize that the system that we need to use is more interdisciplinary, transdisciplinary, and even neodisciplinary. So I am suggesting that post COVID-19, we do have to look hard at the way we organize subjects, we organize curriculum documents. And another thing that what get curriculum developers worry is that we are afraid that the children are not ready for exam, because curriculum at the end of it is to prepare students for exam. That's especially in the third world country, in the developing country. Perhaps examination cannot be too summative. Perhaps we need to also treat examination looking at the continuity in a more formative way. And rethinking, my second point is rethinking pedagogical perspective. We realize that at this point, we have to let the students learn on their own. And we need to facilitate their learning. We need to let go our hand. Although we have been talking about child-centered learning, constructivist approach, but we have not been very successful, especially in the developing country. And so in moving towards a child-centered or constructivist approach, we have to scaffold students' learning. And I think that is something that all of us learn, especially in the developing country and even in the developed country. And we talk about hybrid approach. And that hybrid approach is taking shape in many countries, including in Malaysia. But exactly how to do it well, I think it needs to be researched on. In this pandemic also, the equity of learning is being highlighted in the sense that infrastructure and technology in school in many developing countries, including Malaysia, we find that we do have some problem. And also in other countries around. So infrastructure and technology in school is one. But during lockdown, the parents have to play a role in teaching their kids. So the teachers send, in Malaysia, teachers send learning materials.
Dr. Subon, sorry to interrupt you. You exceeded your 5 minutes. So if you can ask you kindly to wrap up.
Okay, thank you, Dakmara. Sorry about that. Okay, now let me also, My final point is that, you see, there are many old-fashioned strategies being used, including the teacher sending school homeworks to the children, putting in their post box. And all this old-fashioned technology need to be acknowledged. Now, finally, I like to suggest that we, in this pandemic, is forcing us to think about the development power of mind and ways of thinking. And as educators, it is also for us to think about that we have to change our ways of thinking, our ways of doing, and the time to act is right now. Thank you, Dakmara.
Yes, thank you very, very much, Dr. Subun. And sorry again for being rude, but we have to stick to our time. And apparently, Dr. Ido would like to take over.
Merci, merci, informaticien.
Oui, merci, monsieur. Monsieur le ministre, vous avez la parole.
Thank you. Minister, you have the floor. Over to you, sir. Could you please activate your camera? Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. And first of all, my apologies for the connection issues. With the situation that we're living through, the COVID-19 and all of its impact on the education sector, and the sector has meant that we've got to reorganize classes, rethink our timetables and schedules to try to limit all of the negative impacts on classes and ensure that we don't have mass dropouts. So what we decided to do was lighten the curricular load so that we could come up with a lighter overall program. And one of the specificities of Togo is that we didn't really go 100% digital. We had a lot, we did have a lot more interaction. We did have interaction between teachers and learners, but also we were try to envisage experimental classes where the teacher was able to post material to the students. Those students would read the material before interacting with the teacher. So what that would mean is that any time of instruction would be used with fully prepared students. And here I guess I have to make a mention of the financial aspect of this as well, because the whether you're doing a remote or virtual learning, any form of a distance learning means that there has to be at least one computer or some other connected device in the children's home so that they can actually interact. And the government very quickly understood and looked at how it could mobilize all of its resources to make sure that as of January 2021, we could have as many new classrooms built as possible so that we could drop the number of students per class and so as to ensure better social distancing and in that way not saturate the system. The interpreter apologizes, the sound breaks up periodically. This is going to be across primary and secondary education. And it also means that there's going to be a greater requirement for teacher training and recruitment. This means that quality teaching is going to be in greater demand with those additional classrooms. But also, we are hoping to put more digital tools at everyone's disposal, meaning it's a kind of a hybrid approach. Another specificity of the Togo, is that this current academic year is going to be a hybrid system, which is a big first for us. And it's obviously going to be a very different return to school for both the teachers and the students. This means that teachers have had to, and the curricula has had to focus on priority content. And the National Institution for Science and Technology has put all of its wherewithal at the disposal of the Ministry of Education to try to come up with the best solutions possible. All of this is going to mean that all learning is going to reach the broadest cross-section of the learning community possible. Another specificity is that the quarterly educational bulletin is going to try to ensure as big as much cohesion across the territory as well. Furthermore, the 2020 to 2021 school year has meant that there's that when it comes to inspections and pedagogical quality is also going to be tightly controlled.
Who will be taken out of retirement. And in fact, put together an itinerant brigade of inspectors who will be able to ensure that the pedagogical orientations that have been agreed upon actually are applied on the ground. So this is what we're doing in Togo concerning COVID around three major axes: creating new classes, having recourse to digital means, and then the quality of teaching, which will also involve new teaching tools and the institutional reform of the structures that are involved in the training of teachers. Thank you very much. Thank you, Minister, for your words and for showing us these ways forward and the challenges that Togo is confronting, and which UNESCO will certainly take note of, particularly in our regional bureau covering the relevant part of Africa. Thank you, sir.
Dakmara, the floor is yours.
Dr. Ido, thank you. Dr. Soon Boon rightly remembered us that if we talk about rethinking the curriculum, we have to think of rethinking also the documents, not the written curriculum, the intended curriculum, but also how the curriculum is being implemented at classroom level, and then how we assess the achieved curriculum. And she highlighted some of the avenues that also I see in the chat that our participants mentioned. And Mrs. Stefania Giannini also mentioned this thematic approach to be maybe privileged or other ways of integrating among different subjects and trying to really think of what students need to learn in a more flexible way, not in a sequential and linear way. So thank you very much again, Dr. Soon Boon. And we now switch to our last speaker for this session from Africa. So now we switch to Africa. Dr. Gertrude Namubiru, who is the Secretary General of the African Curriculum Association. She's a trained teacher, but she's also holding a PhD in education management and other areas related to education. So, Dr. Namubiru, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you very much, moderator. Thank you very much, everybody. Protocol observed. Before I speak, I would like to make sure that all the participants in this webinar know what African curriculum is. African curriculum is an association that brings together all curriculum and education practitioners to deliberate on issues concerning curriculum design, development, implementation, assessment, and evaluation. It is located in Uganda. That's where we have our secretariat. I would also like to take this moment to thank IBE for the collaboration. Our collaboration started a couple of weeks ago, and we are writing two projects together with IBE. So thank you very much, IBE. I take the pleasure now to talk about the post-COVID-19 envisioned challenges and curriculum reforms focus on crisis preparedness in developing countries. Yeah, during the pandemic, the period of uncertainty, many things happened and many challenges were faced. Now schools are opening slowly by slowly, but as they try to open, people are envisioning some challenges. These challenges include lack of ICT infrastructures and poor network connectivity, inadequate ICT skills possessed by educationists, especially teachers, lack of teachers equipped with a new methodology of curriculum development to enhance school resilience, continuous sanitization of hands and learning environments, coupled with face masking all the time. So these challenges, together with the keeping social distancing at all times, double learning shifts, lack of experience to develop curriculum materials to suit e-learning, have made all African teachers, educationists worried of how we can work within the normal, within the new normal. So what we are suggesting is that we can mitigate these challenges. How? First of all, the challenges of ICT infrastructures and internet connectivity can be addressed by the governments. We can hold governments responsible to increase on the budget of education to ensure that ICT infrastructures are put in place. We should also hold them responsible to ensure that there is internet connectivity in all areas and the cost put on data is reduced to enable all members access internet at all times and can afford to learn. Yeah, on the side of other challenges, we are saying that these challenges can be addressed through curriculum reforms. And we are saying that the countries which are near or which hope to review the curricula should rethink the curricula in terms of the size of content and the way the curricula, the content addresses equity and social responsibility issues. We also say that as they think of reviewing their curricula, they should redesign the curricula and re-emphasize the new normal. Because we don't expect to go back to what we used to call a normal. What we are experiencing now, we take it as our normal and we have to learn to live with it. So in doing this, we are saying that we need to define emergency preparedness goals, focusing on natural emergency preparedness competences that can be contextualized within the pandemic perspective, and we mainstream it in the curricula, so that when we are hit by such a scenario next time, we are able to hold it before it spreads. We are also saying that if they can integrate the content of emergency preparedness into academic subjects to include content on social services, for example, public health, civic behavior, counseling, name it, and give these issues attention, we can be able to manage the situation. We are also thinking that if the countries can think of building new learning communities and use the integrated ICT in curricula and digitalized content to reach out to both online and offline users. We hope that if we do this, we can maintain and we can manage the situation. We are also saying that if we can include blended learning approaches that integrate traditional classroom methods and online digital methods, we can be able to manage the situation. Even if we are hit by another situation, another crisis, we can still hold it. And we are saying that we can as well, because some people said that they have a challenge of managing the double shifts. We are saying that for managing the double shifts, we can emphasize project-based learning approaches to allow learners who study in the shifts to gain knowledge and skills extensively during the time when they are not at school.
Dr. Namubiru, sorry to interrupt you. You exceeded your time. So please, if you can wrap up.
Oh, I'm concluding. And as I conclude, I'm saying that let us remember that teachers and learners are emotionally and psychologically tortured. So we need to develop a more flexible and inclusive curricula. We contextualize it and we make it more relevant to the learners and enhance their innate skills. so that we continue with the learning. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gertrude Namubiru, and sorry again for interrupting you. You helped us figure out again what needs to be done to approach the curriculum in its globality, not just content, but content plus skills and values and attitudes. And then you mentioned very rightly that those responsible for education at different levels, they have to find the means to respond, to address the challenges and to mitigate the risks and the different challenges that face curriculum rethinking and implementation. And then you mentioned several times this term new normal, which is a kind of mantra now for us in education, because we have indeed to think of what to do now. I just remember that in the 90s, I worked in the Ministry of Education as the advisor to a minister who had this reforming now as a slogan, yeah, now or never. And I think this is the conclusion of our session. Thank you very much, and over to Dr. Ido.
Thank you very much for Dakmara for the very good moderation. I'm very sorry to have interrupted you during the course of your moderation due to what we all experienced. So really, thank you very much. You managed to stay in the 30 minutes for your session. It was difficult, but we see that you did it properly. Thank you very much. We are now, colleagues, going to go to our second session, which is of very, very important for us, because the first session, as you saw, is a kind of state of the art of the challenges on the curriculum-related action that can be undertaken after the COVID. Now, we are going to address the main areas to be addressed. So, is to say we are very attentive to this session to know even our work plan that we are preparing, what are the elements that can be taken into account. So for this session, second session, I'm going to give the floor to Abdoulaye Barry, who is a former UNESCO staff, and now he's in Canada. He's working in a cabinet EDUFOR. So Abdoulaye Barry is a very experienced UNESCO staff in the curriculum area. So, Abdoulaye Barry, vous avez la parole.
You have the floor. Abdoulaye Barry. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This session will cover the main ideas of curriculum reform in a post-COVID era. The arrival of the pandemic had sometimes created a certain malaise. People who were completely overwhelmed didn't know how they needed to react so as to keep their education systems up and running. And here, most ministries of education tried to respond to various difficulties, for instance, how to offer essential and high quality learning to learners in education systems. Which would be valid and credible. And we will go over those different experiences to see what people have thought about, what lessons have been learned. And to do this, we will be falling back on our three panelists, Mr. Pibjar from the Bureau for Curriculum Support, Mr. Horacio Ferreira from the Secretary of Education, Culture and Innovation from the Municipality of Cordoba in Argentina, and then Ms. Helicanto Racatarolona, Director of Curriculum and Pedagogical Programs at the Ministry of National Education in Madagascar. So each of our panelists will take the floor for 5 minutes, just as in the previous session, and we will have to ask them to scrupulously respect their speaking time. Let me give the floor, first of all, to Philippe Genaert, who is a retired professor from the University of Quebec in Montreal, and also at the Catholic University of Louvain. He holds a PhD, and his expertise in the curriculum is widely recognized. He's a founder member of the UNESCO Chair in Curriculum Development, which he held until 2017. And today he runs the
curricular support system. Mr. Jean, you have the floor. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for this excellent initiative, and thank you for inviting me. Bravo to the whole team for the remarkable organization involved. Let me start with the issues that the pandemic gives rise to. What we've learned, first of all, I think there's something that we've universally observed in this pandemic today. It allows us to ask many more questions than more localized epidemics have done, which have not given rise to the same sort of debate as we're having today. The curriculum in this context of schools, which have been closed for a relatively long period, and which will probably go on being so for some time, with new school closings being announced, and confinements or lockdowns, the pandemic still spreading today, all of this casts doubt on the curriculum. Here, we're talking much more about listing our challenges than letting our schools slide into a generational catastrophe. That's what our challenge is, and it's a big one. The curriculum is certainly the main lever to avoid that slipping into catastrophe that we cannot allow. So to answer questions which are being asked by educational systems in this pandemic context, the curriculum needs to deal with a series of constraints. The first is that it needs to be flexible and find answers that are different from those proposed by traditional planning. The second condition is that it must be endogenous. Curricular answers are not universal. A curriculum always needs to be a local product, an endogenous product, even if it talks about openness to the rest of the world. The answers we need to find are specific ones for each educational system and need to be contextualized. And responses need to be adapted to different contexts. It needs to be holistic and deal with the issues that are closest to the educational systems by measuring the impact of those responses on all of the dimensions of a given system. It needs to be inclusive and to neglect no individual in the answers that it puts forth. I'm thinking in particular here about digitalization. And our responses should help us, let's say, to attenuate the digital divide which exists in northern countries between populations which have access and those which do not to digitalization, and also the gap between the south and the north. We must also accept hybridization of approaches and make maximum use of technology for all. Our country, Canada, has emphasized the logistics of health and safety, sometimes to the detriment of social cohesion and classroom cohesion, dividing groups and alternating in presential and distance learning. Our country has less emphasized the teaching dimension of planning of teaching and evaluation activities. Traditionally, we know that it's probably one of the difficulties that we will be called upon to confront today. Many educational programs are saturated.
And those kinds of knowledge-dense programs actually stand as an obstacle to learning because they don't give students enough time to assimilate all of the knowledge that they need. And we know that knowledge is a lengthy process. We know that it's not only in the classroom that they learn. And currently, with so many children out of school because of school closures, we need to work on meaningful school programs. But the challenge is not only to enable students and pupils to recover their school activities, which would otherwise penalize them with the schools closing. That's just not enough in itself. I think that's necessary, but at the same time, we've got to make sure that we don't have these knowledge-saturated programs. If I could just give you a few examples. In Tunisia, for example, with the Cambridge Education Office, a lot of work has been done on educational programs to try to challenge. I'm very sorry, could we ask you to wrap up in one more minute? Yes, what they have been doing is essentially to identify the key knowledge and elements and eliminate all redundancies and focus on flagship modules and redistribute all of this across the school timetable. Because basically we're looking at the question of, is the length of learning time actually taken into consideration, the amount of time required for learning? Another thing that they have been doing is to reflect on those core skills, not only academic skills, but also skills for life. Are they mainstreamed into our educational programs? In the Democratic Republic of Congo, in the PECPSU program, and they're looking at the core sciences and humanitarian sciences programs, partially funded by the World Bank, and Oreille Samali is spearheading that effort. And the work that's been done there in the DRC, over and above an overhaul of the program, was also to focus on video capsules that have been posted online to try to stimulate the secondary students and focus on content of learning, but from a different angle. Essentially, the digital aspects of this of these learning modules have been very well taken on board. You can see the Ministry of Education's video capsules, if you look online for them. Before the pandemic, the children had already been taught some of the digital skills required for this kind of learning. Thank you very, very much, Philippe. I'm very sorry, but our time has run out. Oh, I'm very sorry. Have I gone over time? Thank you. Thank you very much. In Congo Brazzaville, activity notebooks had been prepared and distributed among the schools, and some of the work done in chat rooms was undertaken so as to ensure that certain literacy efforts could be continued despite the pandemic. Why focus on this? Because what I'm trying to say is there's a whole plethora of different methods of hybridizing education in this context, and it's important to look at the way different countries are coming up with various solutions to force us to look differently at what a curriculum should be, because too often our curricula are solely focused on academic knowledge, and we need to be broader than that. Thank you. Thank you very much, Philippe. And forgive me for interrupting. I know it's very disconcerting to be interrupted like that, but you have so many worthwhile points to make. But now we're going to continue on with all of your deliberations on the ideal curriculum, what it should look like, and essentially what you're looking at is how to move away from our traditional conventional approach to academic knowledge and a standardized, a homogenized kind of curriculum, and look at, and we're looking at a broad range of different solutions found by different countries. And in this way, we are able to look at the many different solutions, focusing on what are the key skills that we expect to be imparted to our students. Now I should like to hand over to Mr. Horacio Ferreira, who's the Secretary of Education, Culture and Innovation of Cordoba in Argentina. Mr. Horacio. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you. Thank you very much for your invitation to take part. I should like to thank the IBE, Stefania, for her invitation and for allowing me to take part in today's proceedings and look at the impact and prospects for education in the context of COVID-19. If I could just offer a little summary of what we are doing. I think maybe the key idea is basically the possibilities of adapting our curriculum in all of our countries to try and stem some of the negative impacts of school closures and cope with these exceptional circumstances. The challenges and the specificities being faced by the education sector, I think, do require a lot of rethinking for our challenges. Now, if we could look at some of the lessons learned, I think firstly is that we've been having to reassess what face-to-face classroom time means and how it can be used. And it's time to look at all the different stakeholders and the use of technology to see how all of this works together in practical terms. We also wanted to share with you that if we're looking at inequalities, remember, uniform programs are no way to combat inequalities. And I think this is something that the pandemic again has shone a strong light on. I think there are that the key is to address the specificity of each situation and its circumstances. Also, to look at synergies between sciences and humanities, learning based on problems, and dialogue, the nexus between knowledge, dialogue, and different disciplines. All of these, I think, are fertile ground for a deeper understanding of the complexity of the learning environment and the challenges faced in the learning environment today. This means overhauling the curriculum, but it also means that if we are going to guarantee everybody's right to education, we have to look at what we expect them to learn. And so with this focus on the curriculum, I just wanted to highlight a few of the challenges that we've been able to identify in the province of Cordoba, where I work. And I do think that one of the keys is that we've been able to identify, raise the profile of, and recognize and leverage all of the capital that we've accumulated in the student body during lockdown. In other words, they have already done some learning, social, emotional learning, their life experience, their strategies for communicating despite the lockdown, for communicating with the school, for maintaining the learning, all of these kinds of learning, which I think pass under the radar, but which are very important, all need to be brought on board as part of our search for solutions. Secondly, I think it's important to look at if we want a knowledge a curriculum that is tailored for a knowledge society, it's important to look at key content, key learning sequences, how to focus on those as a priority and put all of those at the service of learning. In Cordoba, what we're trying to do is trying to identify the priorities for learning. And this starts with every classroom, every experience. And that is why I also wanted to talk about another key idea is to offer a more knowledge-generating activities for our students. Another idea that I wanted to raise was that if we want to further develop our curriculum, it has to be, we have to look at the enabling aspect. The enabling aspect of the curriculum of how to form connections between between what is being learned and the broader context. In other words, the regional context, the national context. And so I think that this particular challenge is about how to teach people the life skills that they need to address the context in which they're living. So I think there is an important aspect of learning how to learn or teaching people how to learn. And if we can, and even that, then in, rather than seeing the students as empty vessels into which we have to pour knowledge, we need to focus more on how to instill the love of learning and teach. Forgive me, sir, but you have 1 minute left. 1 minute left, thank you, yes. If we want to teach how to learn, then I think one of the important things is not to focus only on economic outcomes, but learning how to learn as an enabling culture. Another consideration is a sustainable development education, remembering that a holistic life skills and learning how to live together, these are very, very important in the current circumstances through which we are living now. Also, in our curriculum, we've got to take into consideration that the school is not the only learning environment for children. Remember that our children and our learners have their own specific contexts and specificities that need to be taken into consideration. In other words, we need to genuinely and meaningfully incorporate technologies from a triple perspective. Firstly, of information and communication. Secondly, learning and knowledge. And thirdly, empowerment and participation. So technology shouldn't just be a tool, but it should be something that children can really buy into and use as a force for good. In other words, if we want education that is renewed, that is more relevant than ever, then it's important for us to looking at the key, perhaps more intense moments of education, but put it into the context of a holistic, diversified method of learning, both from a technological perspective and from social expertise. Forgive me, there are overlapping mics, says the interpreter. Thank you very much, says the speaker.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur Horacio.
Thank you very much, Mr. Horacio. Thank you. We see that you have touched on a lot of key issues that were mentioned before concerning about the essential knowledge that is going to be needed in the future curriculum. For example, the focusing on the certain non-negotiable core aspects of knowledge that need to be imparted and that are important for a holistic education. And also in other words, a complete overall from a critical perspective of our curriculum and development of capacities for life skills for our learners. And again, this is something that UNESCO is looking at learning, how to learn, how to teach people to learn, and how to put this at the service of sustainable development. In other words, a complete overhaul of education in the current context, and yet taking into consideration national specificities. Thank you very much, Horacio Ferreira. Now I should like to hand over to Ms. Helicanto Svipan, Tandefitra Rakotovololana, Director of Curricular and Pedagogical Research at the Ministry of Education in Madagascar. You have the floor, madam. Thank you, Mr. Director, for giving me the floor. Ladies and gentlemen, dear panelists, greetings to one and all. First of all, I should like to start by thanking the International Bureau of Education for having invited Madagascar to take part in this webinar. We are proud to take part, and also our thanks particular to the Association of African Countries, and in particular, Madame Gertrude, who had included us in this webinar. Now, as concerns the key topics to discuss, particularly the post-COVID curricula changes that we've been discussing today, well, what I can say is to share with you some of Madagascar's solutions to the crisis, especially given that our school year only started 1 week ago. Firstly, we were looking at boosting the capacities of our teachers and to ensure that all of the teaching wherewithal and learning wherewithal were provided. When we talk about teacher capacity building, this meant concretely ensuring that there were connected tablets and devices available in the schools, and also capacity building for central training wherewithal. Concerning the device for interactive content on e-learning platforms, and also the design of interactive content on different projects, so as to ensure that there is enough resilience in the face of potentially successive crises, and to ensure that our teaching staff, because we had already started during the lockdown period to look into this, but we wanted to design and continue to disseminate the learning programs that we already have, to offer guides to our teaching staff when it came to learning management in emergency and crisis situations, so as to facilitate their role. When I talk about drafting and tailoring additional content for self-learning, essentially it was during the lockdown period that the Minister of Education designed the self or complementary learning content, because a lot of this was going to be done on screen, so it meant that pupils were going to need internet access, and that is why, given that they would be learning through screens, the idea was to come up with additional learning content to nourish that e-learning and distant learning, and this was going to be replicated for the upcoming school year, which, as I said, started a week ago. So it was essentially through a studio of the Ministry of Education that some audiovisual material and IT material was set up on a permanent basis for self-learning or distance learning, so as to have some core common subjects. And this could be rolled out across the system. So that's what I can say about content. And finally, about institutional strengthening.
An emergency fund in the government budget, so as to reconstruct and renovate classrooms, so that they can have students go back to school in good conditions. we would also need to have capacity building locally so as to be able to increase teaching capacities. This is how Madagascar intends to step up its crisis response. Madagascar is an island which is often confronted with crises, sometimes linked to climatic events. But in this case, the lessons drawn from the pandemic have allowed us to define new strategies with hybrid learning, with distance teaching, so that some of these may continue in the long term. Thank you. Thank you so much. You were only 28 seconds over time. That was phenomenal. Makes things easier, as Dakmara said earlier. So if we go a bit over the title of our session today, the different areas to be tackled in curriculum reform. And in curricular reform, there are a variety of different components. We heard in Madagascar that there were three principal aspects. One is capacity building for teachers using different ways and means, elaboration and development of complementary measures for teaching and learning, extending some measures which had already been taken but which were stepped up during the pandemic, and then thirdly, strengthening of institutions, including an emergency fund. So this was a series of different experiences throughout the world, with a fairly global introduction by the first speaker. These are different ways forward which are before us, which we may reflect on or use so as to take up curriculum reform in the post-COVID era. Now, let me give the floor back to Ido, and thank you very much for your attention. Thank you so much for your moderation. It wasn't obvious to pull this off when our speakers had so much to say and so little time to say it in. Thank you all for agreeing to be panelists and for making heroic efforts to stick to your time limits. And thank you for trying to summarize some of the ways forward for the future we're trying to identify. That said, throughout our discussions, people took the floor in the chat to ask questions, and our teams have collected these. I will now give the floor to Yuji, who is one of our colleagues from IBE-UNESCO, so that she could perhaps take 10 minutes to see some of the most important questions asked and some of the pertinent remarks made in the chat. Thank you, Lily.
Thank you very much, and welcome now to the Q&A session. And this session will last half an hour. And thanks to the very active participation from different regions of the world, we now have received a big number of contributions and questions. So much appreciated. And we will not have the time to address all the questions, but we will try our best to address the most representative ones during this session and continue to address the other ones as well after the webinar. So now I have a first question for Madame Stefania Giannini. This question is from Mr. Olivier Tanque from Cameroon. So his question is, what are the main missions of the Coalition Mondiale de l'Education mise en place par l'UNESCO en mars 2020? Quelles sont les missions de la Coalition Mondiale de l'Education?
What are the missions of coalition that had been set forth by UNESCO in March 2020. I think this is a question of general interest, which could be important for everyone.
Madame Stefania Giannini, could you please shed light on this question, if it's possible? Yes?
Madame Giannini, je crois qu'elle a des contraintes.
I think that Madame Giannini has a timing problem. I think there are others who are here who might be able to answer in her stead, as well as other directors who are here.
Yes, and if that is the case, maybe I can add on another question that is to UNESCO as a whole, so that Mr. Brain and Mr. Ido, so that you may consider together replying them. The other question to UNESCO is whether UNESCO can organize a curriculum conference in the interest of making the education relevant to societies in the developing countries, especially in this COVID and post-COVID environment and crisis. Thank you. Mr. Ido and Mr. Boren, it is possible for you to address the questions.
Merci, Lily. Boren first.
Merci.
Thank you, Dr. Ido, and thank you, G, for the question and for the participant. I think what probably would be important to highlight regarding the Global Education Coalition mandate is that we launched the coalition to leave no one behind. So one of its important agenda is to address the challenges of equity and inclusion in the context of the COVID-19 response. Now, what we are doing, and maybe to give three examples of the work we are doing. First, we are supporting member states in developing education response to the COVID-19. This can include the teacher training, it includes online platform, it includes education resources development, curriculum reform, and also building a specific strategy to respond to the COVID. And to give an example, this is what we are doing in Senegal. We have been working with the government to develop a response to the COVID-19, which includes different dimension. We have worked to support the operation of the online platform, and we train teachers on digital and pedagogical skills. And we are continuing with the next steps of mobilizing more technical and financial partners to support the plan for connectivity that the government has developed with the support of the Global Education Coalition. The second area of our work has been focusing on some major challenges that we have seen across the countries. And I think the speakers today refer to them: connectivity and the digital gap, teachers, and inclusion, equity, and gender equality. And there we have launched, for example, the Global Teacher Campus, which is an initiative to equip the teachers with the pedagogical and digital skills. We have launched an initiative related to youth skills development and equipping youth with the employability skills. And some of the speakers refer to the set of skills that are required for life and work broadly. And the third area of the work that the coalition is doing is about data research and policy advice. To give an example, we are continuing having the mapping of school closures and education system disruption. We have conducted a survey with UNICEF and the World Bank on education responses, and the report has been published yesterday. We have developed with McKinsey a toolkit on education response, and we are conducting other research and analysis that we are sharing with the different stakeholders at the global level, at regional, at national level. So these are examples of what the coalition is doing, and I will let the director Ido respond regarding the conference. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Boren. Yes, the answer is yes, because organizing conferences, etc., offering opportunity for experience exchange between countries is one of the functions of UNESCO, our convening function. We will continue this. But what we are going to put emphasis on, because these conferences will allow us to talk about curriculum, to share experience, etc. But what IBE is committed to do in the coming years is to put accent on the capacity building at national and regional level to address curriculum issues in terms of training, in terms of research on curriculum, and in terms of publication on curriculum at national and regional level. So the capacity building function will be the one that we are going to stress more. Of course, from time to time, it will be necessary to organize conferences to put people together to share experience. Thank you very much, Lily.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Borin and Mr. Ido, for the very comprehensive answers to these questions. I now have another question to Mr. Samuel Conde, President of EDUCA Dominican Republic, and this question, if he is still present. And the question is from Mr. Maurice Nkusi from Namibia. How can curriculum be a catalyzer for building resilient systems to effectively respond to the need raised by COVID-19? So how can curriculum be a catalyzer for building resilience in education in order to respond to the challenges of COVID-19? Mr. Samuel Conde?
Yes.
Can you please share some of your thoughts with us? Thank you.
Certainly. With the preamble that I am not an educational scholar or expert, I am, as stated in my introduction, I'm really an entrepreneur, a businessman, now devoting a lot of time to supporting education. I think that the curriculum in dealing with distance learning and faced with a situation that many of the curricula, at least in the Dominican Republic, is very loaded with many, it's an antiquated curricula, overloaded and not taking into account the amount of information that is available at the internet level. So we need to concentrate the time of the program or the transmission of the, we need to moderate at our aspirations, I would say. We need to, the aspirations of the distance learning program needs to be moderated, taking into account that we're dealing with young people, many of them in developing countries, totally skillful of this learning as the teachers themselves, because the young people, they are the teachers that need to modify their methods and therefore the contents. Also need to be modified or adapted to the limitations and not availability of other content, because anyone with a relatively smartphone, and so I think that I hope I've been able to share my thought, and it's clear. I'm open to any other questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Conde, for your voice reflections. I would now move to another set of questions that are directed to Mr. Subun. And there are more than 5 questions for her, but I will try to summarize them. So first question, Mr. Dr. Subun, would you please let us know what practical steps you suggest to achieve or to implement the 5 points that you mentioned in your presentation? Also, what would be the strategy that we could apply to meet the challenges relating to shortening the curriculum and lightening the curriculum, which is most of the time overloaded, as Mr. Conde also said just now? And how could we ensure inclusive education during these pandemic times? And more general questions to you as well, Dr. Suboom, because many countries, in many countries, the schools are still locked down and for a long time. And what concrete measures can we take in curriculum implementation to avoid a generation catastrophe in terms of learning? Dr. Suboom, are you still with us?
Yes, yes. Thank you, Julie.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Well, I actually have answered some of it there, but I will give my answer verbally too. Yeah. All right. I think there were many questions on how to shorten the curriculum. Now, I was a curriculum developer for close to 30 years. So when I have to oversee the many subjects, we actually realized that, like it or not, there are a lot of overlap. Now, I give an example. You might be talking about teaching parts of bodies in English, but you are also teaching parts of body in the science. So if the curriculum developer can sit down and try and map it out, then I mean, in times of pandemic, when you have to shorten the curriculum, this is one concrete way that you can do. You look at all the overlap and you try to teach thematic and not teach by subjects. Now, when we do curriculum for subjects, we overlap sometimes because it's a spiral curriculum design, because we want to make context when we teach. But when in pandemic, we could sit down and look at the overlap and try to overcome it. Now, shortening curriculum is not something that you can do in a short while. I don't believe in shortening curriculum in such a hurry. But in times of pandemic, this is something that we can do. Now, there is this question about the practical point. The practical point, the 5 points that I have raised are things for us to think about. Yeah, because if we want to look at each practical point, probably I would have to say that we have to think out of the box. We cannot be doing what we are doing now, because it does not solve the problem. We find our system to be very rigid, the way we develop the curriculum. So we do have to think out of the box. But right in the pandemic now, we can't do much. But we have to prepare, you know, we have to prepare for future. But I believe that right in the pandemic, what we can do is prepare lots of resource material, find some way to get to the students. We can use the old-fashioned way. Some teachers put it in the post box, or, you know, with bicycle, bring it to the kids, or to television, to radio, so many ways. So all these ways we have to do, and we have to be motivating the children. We have to give confidence to them that they can learn. We have to trust that. So at this time of pandemic, we have to do that. That is the practical point that I can give, and give them the motivation that they can learn. But subsequently, we have to do better planning in case of future catastrophe. Now, for inclusive education, yes, definitely that is a challenge in time like that. But what I can say is that we cannot give up, and we have to continue to do what we can do. I hope that answers some of the questions. Thank you, Jilly.
Thank you very much, Dr. Suboom. Yes. Thank you very much for your very clear answers, and you gave examples and good experiences regarding the practical ways of dealing the challenges and of curriculum integration and etc. through teaching. Thank you very much again. And I next have a set of questions that go to Dr. Gertrude Namubiru. A number of questions as well. So I'll try to summarize. The first question is your idea, Dr. Gertrude, of developing flexible and inclusive curriculum seemed very good. Could you suggest some concrete ways of doing this as well? And another question also comes from different participants, but they go in the same direction. What initiative has the African Union taken to train teachers in digital content development? Because most teachers are computer literate, but or they are able to integrate technology in their lessons, but they cannot or they lack skills to develop and design digital content for curriculum implementation. So do you think the African Union and can work with UNESCO to develop professional development programs and platform for these? Mr. Gertrude, are you still with us?
Okay, thank you very much, Lily.
Thank you.
Yeah, for the first question, I cannot recall the whole question the way it has been, but at least I can give an answer like this, that what we can do, we can contextualize and democratize curriculum to allow learners to learn what they feel like or what they feel their interests are and what skills are demanded in the area where they are learning from. In so doing, we shall be able to make the curriculum flexible and user-friendly and also relevant to the people we design it for. Then the second one about the initiative by African Union on training teachers, I think this question is addressed to a wrong person because at the African Union, African Curriculum Association coordinates a curriculum cluster and the teacher education cluster is coordinated by IKIBA, UNESCO IKIBA. If they are present, maybe they can be able to answer that question. Thank you very much. Hello.
Thank you.
Lily, can I say something on this question?
Sure, please. Thank you very much, Mr.
Thank you. I don't think that Yumiko from IKBA is there. So Gertrude, let me just add to what you just said. To say that this is a very important question. We are in the area of numeric and digital skills. So just to ensure that IBE is planning in the next years to really work on a digitalized curriculum and promote digital skills, above all for learners in developing countries. Because we all know that there are many countries in Africa, Latin America, and Pacific where students start school in from primary school to university without even seeing, not to say touching, a computer, which is not acceptable today. So promoting digital skills is one of the area of work that we are going to promote in the curriculum for the future. So it's an area where we look forward to work, to working with African Union, with the Association of African Curriculum, et cetera, and other partners to promote digital skills in the learning settings and the curriculum of developing countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ido and Dr. Gertrude for replying to these questions together. And I would now move to another questions, and this set of questions would be directed to all the panelists. And if please, after I ask the question, I would invite the panelists to either to take the floor directly or to signal to ask your willingness to take the floor, or you can also raise your hand through the platform. Okay, so this question is about quality assurance of different forms of remote and blended learning. How can we address the issues of quality assurance with regard to the contents and the learning packages that are put together in different formats or for remote and blended learning? So maybe I can move to some other questions regarding teaching learning as well. To what extent has the crisis enabled us to better identify what is essential for learning, in particular, what are the new essentials in learning? So what the crisis has enabled us to, how the crisis has enabled us to better identify what is essential and what is the new essential in learning. And the next questions about teaching and learning, and how can we make sure to achieve the predefined learning goals which were set before COVID-19? And how can we ensure the presence of instructors during online learning? How can we make sure that instructors motivate students to pay attention and participate actually from distance? And how can we help teachers to carry out interdisciplinary teaching and by taking into account the synergies between humanities and science, for example? So this is a set of questions that are relating to quality assurance, teaching, learning, and the content of curriculum during the crisis. So I would like to invite the participants to take the floor and to indicate us if they are willing to react.
5 minutes.
Maximum. 5 minutes, please.
We have 5 minutes for that, for this. Because we have to conclude the webinar in the coming 10 minutes. So we have 5 minutes for this session. If there are panelists or moderators, if they want to take the floor, as Lily said.
May I answer one question on essential?
Lily, you are muted.
What is essential in the essential learning and the essential content of learning?
In terms of the pandemic, what have we learned?
Essential in the curriculum. What essentially should be learned by the learners before and now after in the new normal.
Yeah, as I try to answer
the essential this, knowledge and the competences. Yes, please answer this.
As I try to answer Dr. this,
Gertrude,
yes, I'm saying that the pandemic, first of all, has shown us that what we have been teaching the learners is not enough to make them go through the world. And what we have learned from this is that there are some essential things we have been neglecting, which are so crucial and essential, like the values, norms, behavior, and maybe functional skills. We have concentrated so much on the academics, forgetting the gist of the education system. Now what we can do, we can integrate and make sure that we pay attention to the, what we have integrated. We can integrate the non-academic with the academic subjects so that we ensure that we continue without being hit by any crisis, any crisis is on its way to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gertrude. I would like to invite other panelists, if you can, anyone can also react to this group of questions.
Something?
Yes, please. Boon.
Yeah. Dr. So I would say that this interdisciplinary, the questions about how can we do interdisciplinary, I think as educators, if we can sit down and think of the purpose of education, the purpose of each of the learning outcome in the document, in the curriculum document, I am sure we will be able to do interdisciplinary, because the meaning of learning is to solve problem. So to me, interdisciplinary is the educators sit down and look at the purpose of learning as an essential step to do that.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Dr. Suboon. Is there any other panelists that would like to take the floor? Okay.
Hola, hola.
Hola.
Yes, do you hear me?
Horacio, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, thank you. Yes, thank you for giving me the floor. Yes, in particular, I think that some learning content that is currently being developed, I think, is hints at a way forward, but I don't think that we've done enough on emotional intelligence and learning in this regard. I think if we want to address this, I think this is something that the pandemic has shown us. Another issue that we've learned is this multidisciplinary or interdisciplinary approach. In Argentina, we have done much, for example, on the integration of knowledge and what what this essentially means is that the interdisciplinary nature of these kinds of projects has to actually also look at teacher support. In other words, seeing how teachers themselves are expected to address this is important. Otherwise, you're missing some of the key knowledge. For example, if you look at the realities of virtual learning and the need for understanding or compromise as basic life skills, and I think all of these do need to be mainstreamed further into our curricula. I think it's important that this has been mentioned, and it's something that we might not have looked at had it not been for the pandemic. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, and you have laid very important avenues of moving forward. I would like to thank you for that. I have been informed by Mr. Ido that we have come to the end of this Q&A session due to time limitation. I would like to really to thank our distinguished panelists and participants again for this very generous interactions during this session, and we will make sure to address those questions that have not been addressed after the webinar. So we welcome everybody to stay in touch with us through our various channels of communication. So I would give the floor back to Mr. Ido. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lily. It has not been easy, but you made it so good. Thank you very much for that. And thank you very much. All the colleagues, the panelists, thank you very much for your contributions. And now we are going toward the closing of our meeting, and we have maximum of five minutes to do it. So I will give the floor now to a person who has been key in the organization of this webinar in terms of partnership. I've been working with him for a long time up to today. So it's my pleasure now to give the floor to Boren Chakroum, who is the Director, Division of Policies and Lifelong Learning Systems in the Education Sector at Headquarters. Thank you very much again, Boren, you and your team who supported us in this webinar. The floor is yours for your words.
Thank you very much, Director Ido, and I know we are running late, so I will be very short. Just to reconfirm, I think UNESCO's commitment to engage with member states, to engage with the national stakeholders regarding the response to the COVID-19, but also building further the resilience and reimagining education for a more inclusive and equitable societies. I think I would like to congratulate you for a successful meeting. We were really a very large number of participants and engagement, question in the chat, and also high quality intervention from the speakers. Maybe I would like to mention three takeaway from my point of view that are important. One is the need for continued dialogue, peer learning, and engagement on this area. We didn't resolve all the problems. We have learned a lot, but obviously the challenges are important and are huge. They are interconnected, and we would need to come to this area and make more analysis, more knowledge sharing and experience sharing across the countries. And this webinar is the first one, which is amazing. It's the first one after almost 7 or 8 months on curriculum. We have had all type of webinars, and thanks to you, to your leadership and the team, we have managed to put on the table the challenge of the curriculum. The second takeaway, we see that there are different challenges that are coming across the countries on different stages, from responses, strategies, and we have heard from the different countries, to more resilience building actions that we have also heard from the countries, like building more infrastructure, developing the capacities of teachers, engaging with the technology and digital investment. But also we have heard about a third phase, which is about reimagining. And we have heard how we need to redesign the curriculum, the element of content, and how we can engage with the learner-centered pedagogies, also the lifelong learning dimension. And those are what we can call part of the new normal that we have to consider. Maybe the third area that I think is important is that we need to take actions. It's not only, and I think there were some questions in the chat about that. And there, I think Director Edu and myself, we have been working together to say we will not only do webinars, which are very important, we will not only organize conference, but we would like also to launch an important initiative through the Global Education Coalition to support countries, to support these challenges related to how we can reform curriculum now, tomorrow, but also for the future. And this is only a rendezvous. Please stay tuned, and we will work together to launch this initiative to support countries through the Global Education Coalition. And we'll be very happy in the next few weeks to share the contour of this initiative. Thank you again, Director Edu, and thank you to all the speakers and all the participants, to the team from headquarters and from Geneva who worked hand in hand to make this event a success. Merci.
Merci infiniment, cher ami. Merci.
Thank you very, very much, my dear friend. Thank you. And now I should like to also warmly thank you for those words, and also for the recent figures that are most recently brought out. I'd also like to extend a thanks to the ADG Stefania for the time that she spent with us, and also to our two ministers, and also the Minister of Dominican Republic stayed a long time with us before heading off. Thank you so much for giving us so much of your time. My thanks also to the moderators for their excellent timekeeping skills and moderating skills. It's not an easy task, but thank you for ensuring that everybody had a fair amount of speaking time. So thank you very, very much for your efforts in that. My thanks also to our panelists. It's really not easy in 5 minutes just to sum everything up, but thank you very much. We would love to have given you more time, but thank you very much for everything that you did. And also my thanks to all of the participants. I was actually looking through the chat. There are so many useful things in the chats, and I saw that there was a Dr. Abu Ali, and he said one thing that struck me. He said, I'm so sad not to have an answer to my question. Yes, Dr. Ali, we agree with you. We shall do our best to see if we can give some form of a written answer to the questions that we've said. Thank you. Thank you to all of those who had written to us with their questions, for the moderators, for the panelists, and so we're going to see if we can and respond to those, even though we didn't get time during the meeting. And also, thank you very much for all of the information, for the recommendations, for your ideas. And we're hoping to work closely with the national bureaus, with the regional offices, so that we can work together on the kinds of solutions that we discussed today. And obviously, it's through the cooperation between headquarters and the field offices that we can really make sure that we've got our finger on the pulse. Also, we've been talking a lot about digital tools, about digital access, and how this can be put at the service of curriculum development and curriculum revision. And this is something that's absolutely crucial for the future. We're very aware of it. And so we will certainly be giving this more thought going forward so that we can meet everybody's expectations. And as I was saying, everything that has been put into the chat, we will do our best to respond to all of your most worthwhile questions. I should also like to thank each and every one of you for your patience, for your participation. And it was up to, it was my colleague that told me that we were up to 614 registered participants. And I think we've still got some 300 odd who've stayed with us right to the end. I want to extend a thank you for your interest in the IBE, in UNESCO's work. Thank you very, very much for staying with us. Thank you. And I wish everyone a very good evening and look forward to seeing you again. Thank you.